President, please be seated.
Le président. Veuillez vous asseoir.
The court is now back in session.
Reprise de l'audience.
And again, the floor is given to the co-prosecutors to continue presenting their key documents, and you may proceed.
Pour sa présentation des documents clés. Vous avez la parole.
Mr. Deputy Co-Prosecutor, please hold on. And I notice the International Defense Council for Kyrgyzstan phone on her feet. You may proceed.
Oui, merci, Monsieur le Président. Excusez-moi, Monsieur le Co-procureur. Juste avec votre autorisation, Monsieur le Président, je souhaiterais formuler une courte requête.
I would like to make a short request, Mr. President, with your leave.
Yes, you may proceed, Counsel.
Le Président, allez-y.
Je vous remercie. Je souhaitais demander au nom de l'équipe de Kyrgyzstan de pouvoir avoir la possibilité de répondre à la présentation des documents clés par le co-procureur et le co-avocat des parties civiles lundi matin, étant précisé que j'ai discuté avec mon confrère de l'équipe de Nunchea qui m'indique qu'ils n'entendent pas présenter de documents clés, ce qui voudrait dire qu'en tout état de cause, nous ne prendrions pas plus de temps que prévu pour les réponses de la défense et que l'audience pourrait se poursuivre normalement comme vous l'aviez prévu dans le cadre de la planification initiale. Je précise que cette demande est simplement faite pour que ce soit la réponse soit plus structurée avec les ERN précis en réponse aux documents présentés par les procureurs, avec également d'autres parties de documents présentés par les procureurs qui seront utiles dans le cadre de votre réponse. Donc voilà la courte requête que je souhaite formuler compte tenu de l'agenda de la Chambre.
Given, of course, the Chamber's schedule.
President, Judge Lavergne, you have the floor.
Vous avez la parole, Monsieur le Juge Lavergne.
Oui, merci, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Pour que les choses soient parfaitement claires, je comprends que les deux équipes de défense ne présenteront pas de documents clés.
Both defense teams will not present any key documents.
Je voudrais aussi savoir si l'équipe de la défense de Nunchea, dont on a compris qu'elle ne présenterait pas de documents clés, entend faire des commentaires sur les documents qui ont été présentés par les co-procureurs et par les co-avocats principaux pour les parties
civiles. No, we will not, Judge Levin.
Non, dit Coppe.
President,
le président.
The chamber noticed the request made by the International Council for Kyrgyzstan Pond to have an opportunity to make comments to the key documents presentation made by the co-prosecutors and the lead co-lawyers, and that she needs appropriate time to make such a preparation. There is sufficient ground for this request, for that the chamber grants you your request. So that on Monday next week, we will give the floor to the defense team for Kyrgyzstan to make observations on those documents presented by the co-prosecutors and the lead co-lawyers for civil parties. And for the remaining time, we will start with the witnesses for the new fact. And the deputy co-prosecutor, you may now resume your presentation on key documents.
Monsieur le co-procureur, vous avez la parole pour la présentation de vos documents.
Thank you, Mr. President. Your Honours, good afternoon, Council.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Bon après-midi, Messieurs les Juges.
Your Honours, just firstly, we're wondering whether and we don't expect an answer now, whether you envisage that the prosecution would reply to Qusam Khan's response would be useful to know that at some point today, if replies are expected or not. Your Honours, we intend to stick to the schedule that you set in terms of timing for the key document presentations. The prosecution has provided a list to the senior legal officer on the 25th of August last week of the documents they wanted to bring to Your Honour's attention. On that list, we had documents for 1st of January Dam, Trepang Tamai Dam and Kampong Chenang Airport. Certainly, in relation to Kampong Chenang Airport or airfield construction site, we won't have enough time fully to present those documents. However, I will summarise the content of the remainder of the documents which we would like Your Honours to consider. And we would also ask that that list that we provided to the Chamber be something as a useful guide of documents that we think are important in demonstrating the crimes that occurred at Kampong Chenang Airport and also the involvement of the leaders of the airport site in purges. So if I can briefly summarise the documents that we would like Your Honours to take aware of. First, this morning we presented some documents in relation to Sue Met, commander of Division 502, responsible for the airfield. We presented some correspondence that he had with Doik, the chairman of S21, the torture and killing centre there. And to show that the Sue Met was actively involved in the purge of military personnel. The other documents that would help demonstrate that, letters from or letters, documents, telegrams from Sue Met to Doik, we would like Your Honours to take into account to support that proposition. That's E31054, and that's dated the 1st of June 1977. Second document, E39381, also appears in the form of E31050, and that's dated the 2nd of June 1977. Then E31141, dated the 28th of July 1977. E31040, dated the 10th of August 1977. E38385, dated the 4th of October 1977. And E31087, dated the 3rd of October 1977. These are all documents, in addition to the other ones that were sort of read out more completely this morning, that are correspondence from Sue Met to Doik, either sending people to S21 from various divisions, or alternatively requesting information from Doik as to what detainees at S21 had said about other members of his division or other RAK members that he was able to investigate. Those documents show that Sue Met was actively participating in purging, in particular, killing of subordinates and other army personnel without any legal justification. Now, either from the Kampong Chenang airfield and or from other places. They support the witness testimony of the purging of workers through killings, disappearances, re-educating and refashioning at the airfield by Division 502, of which testimony you've heard recently. The second group, or the second two documents we would like to refer to, Your Honours, that demonstrate the purging of Division 710 at the airfield. Your Honours will remember Division 710 in terms of the numbers of people at the airfield. That did not appear on an inventory of the RAK in 1977, but clearly from this document, contemporaneous document, it's E3-1182, dated the 6th of July 1978, from Bung Reng to the General Staff, RAK General Staff. It clearly shows that certainly significant numbers of Division 710 were working at the airfield, and there was an active role in purging that division, certainly in general terms, in that document. And that's dated July 1978. And then, Your Honours, that record or that document we submit would read well with E3-369, which is a written record of interviews with the Office of the Crown Investigation Judges of a Division 170 regiment commander who is in fact present at the airfield and gives evidence of the crimes and the purges there. Thirdly, a third document demonstrates a different idea, and this idea is particularly in relation to the idea of enslavement, the fact that soldiers slash workers, whether or not they had the ability to leave the airport or whether they were detained within those grounds as large as they were. And that document is E3-1094, dated the 4th of August 1978, from Office 41, that's in the West Zone, addressed generally to Ankar. And it talks about a number of incidents in July where detainees or soldiers or workers escaped from the airport and they were arrested on different occasions. And they were perceived or viewed to be as enemies for doing so.
It also,
that document further talks about the importance of taking measures, security measures, having soldiers more heavily guard the perimeter of the airfield to stop those escapes from occurring again.
And
that, we submit, is relevant to this whole issue of whether or not people sent to the airfield had freedom of movement, were they enslaved to the extent that they were unable to leave. And then perhaps the fourth and last sort of group of documents that would like Your Honours to look at and consider in light of all of the evidence. And they are the documents that relate to what actually happened to East Zone detainees that were taken to the airfield as a result of a massive purge of that zone. What actually happened to them when the Vietnamese came and the airport was abandoned? Your Honour has heard some testimony of that, but also today Your Honours have heard a document read out to you talking about or discussing or providing evidence of some of those East Zone soldiers being executed near Reims railway station, which is about 20 kilometres from the airfield. There are two witnesses that give very specific evidence in this regard, in addition to what Your Honours have heard, and that's E3-7893, and that witness talks about his observations of the massacre at the Teak Pos Pagoda, and another witness, which is near Reims town, train station, a few kilometres away, and another witness that talks about another massacre, E3-7894, a massacre at an old fort, which is in the other direction from the Reims train station, but both talk about massacres and executions of East Zone soldiers that fled the airport when the Vietnamese arrived in the area, and they discuss how they were tricked to to come and line up and be armed to fight the Vietnamese. And once those identifications were made clear, they were executed. The prosecution is well aware that the accused aren't charged with those executions because they appear, they occurred, it appears that they occurred after the the temporal jurisdiction of this court. And so we're not asking Your Honours to make any findings or use that evidence to prove those facts, but clearly that's not possible, nor is the case. But we do ask Your Honours to think about that evidence when you're thinking about were those East Zone detainees or workers, were they being persecuted at the Camp Ong Chanang airfield? And so evidence of how they were treated after, we would say, is relevant to your determination of whether or not they were treated in a persecutionary manner whilst they were at the airport. And we would submit that evidence is not barred, but certainly no findings of fact as to the accused guilt in relation to those massacres. We understand that. Your Honour, just to finally conclude, in short, the documents presented today demonstrate that as Division 502 were managing the building of the airfield in order to defend themselves from outside enemies, clearly that was Vietnam and other foreign powers, they were simultaneously killing, re-educating and refashioning some of the builders of the airfield that they believed were enemies in order to defend themselves from internal enemies. The documents presented show that the RAK, including the command of Division 502, believe that the internal enemies were in fact a greater threat than external enemies. They demonstrate that the RAK Division 502 leadership, which was responsible for the construction of the airfield, viewed that this dual approach of building whilst purging was neither contradictory nor self-defeating. So, Your Honours, that concludes the presentation on Camp Ong Chanang. I think we hand the floor to, I'd ask Your Honours to hand the floor to the civil parties. I believe they have 5 or 10 minutes to present some documents in this area.
President, thank you.
Merci.
And the Chamber now hands the floor to the lead co-lawyers for civil parties. Thank you, Mr. President. Good afternoon, Your Honours.
Bon après-midi.
Good afternoon, everyone in and around the courtroom.
Madame, Messieurs les juges, bon après-midi à tous.
In relation to Camp Ong Chanang Airport work site, I do not have many key documents
présentés au sujet de l'aéroport de Camp Ong Chanang.
I only have two.
Je n'en ai que deux en fait.
Civil party applications.
Ce sont des demandes de constitution de parties.
I will read brief extractions from the two
extraits.
Applications. The two civil parties at that time were minors when they were sent to the Camp Ong Chanang airport work site.
Quand ils ont été envoyés à l'aéroport de Camp Ong Chanang.
They both were around 15 to 16 years old.
Ils étaient tous âgés de 16 à 18 ans.
The first civil party, namely Ru Ren,
qui s'appelle Ru Ren,
has filed a civil party application, that is document E3-4694. And Mr. Rouren was recruited and army stationed in Phnom Penh, and later on was transferred to work at the Kampong Chenang airport work site.
De l'aéroport de Kampong Chenang.
He was put into the 703 division at the time, and allowed to read an extract from his civil application with the command EAN at 0036-5048. In English, 0039-39-83-4444. And the EAN in French is at 00-90-98-41-41. And below is the following quote.
Je cite.
In 1977, I was transferred
on m'a transféré
to work at the airport work site in Kampong Chenang province. I was asked to break a rock at the mountain and I worked days and nights.
J'y ai travaillé jour et nuit.
And I remained working there until late
1978.
There were many workers who died
beaucoup de travailleurs sont morts
from starvation,
de faim,
while others were sent to be killed by
l'Anka.
There were countless of workers who died there.
Il était impossible de les compter.
End of
ceux
quote.
Qui sont morts.
And lastly, the second civil application that I have on my list
la prochaine demande de constitution
is that
de
of Mr. Chai Hirp.
Chai Hirp.
And the document is
E3/64-2-7A.
The civil party stated that initially,
dans
he lived in
Srayau,
Kompongswai district.
Il habitait à Srayau, dans le district de Kompongswai,
qui s'appelle maintenant le district
de Stensai.
And later on, he was drafted into 310 division, as there was a subdivision where children were enlisted.
Sous-division.
That division
d'enfants
was based in Phnom Penh, according to the information in the civil party application, and it was based
near
the vicinity opposite the Calmet Hospital.
En face de l'hôpital de Calmet.
He was assigned to provide treatment to patients in that hospital as well, and later on he was transferred
suite,
to work at the Kampong Chenang airport work site. And I'd like to make a quote from
si
the Khmer page with the EAN at 00-58-15-29-29. And there is no EAN in English
Le document
or
n'est pas
French.
Disponible en anglais ou en français.
And I'd like to read the following extract.
Laissez-moi lire.
Later on, there was an event of arresting
Saupem.
And after that event took place, I was transferred to work at the airport work site at the Kampong Chenang. My task that I was assigned to was to clean and clear the rubbish at the work site, to work with cement and to water vegetables there. I had to work to wake up at 3 or 4 o'clock to water vegetables there. people kept disappearing from my unit,
dans mon unité,
and
les gens
I did not know
de
where they disappeared to Antarctica. Journalists, these are the two documents
voilà,
that we would like to present as part of the key documents in relation to the Kampong Chunam airport website. Briefly, they talk about the airport work site itself and about their involvement while they were working there.
Ces deux parties civiles expliquent leur expérience.
And in order to clarify the document number, allow me to repeat it.
Et si vous me permettez, je vais répéter les codes.
The civil party application is E3/4694.
Constitution de partie civile, code E3/4694, demande.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
President, thank you.
Le Président, merci.
And again, the floor is given through the co-prosecutors to continue making key document presentation, and you may proceed.
Pour leur présentation des documents.
Thank you, Mr. President, and good afternoon to your honors and to counsel. As your honors are aware, I will be continuing with the Trapyong Tama Dam portion of the presentation. And the first document I'd like to draw your attention to is E3/771. This document is an issue of Revolutionary Youth magazine. It's dated July-August 1977. And it's an interesting document because it contains several pages related to the Trapyong Tama Dam project. The relevant ERNs are 0050 9685-87 in English, 0037 6343-45 in Khmer, and 0059 4052-55 in French. And the first thing I would draw your attention to is that this document contains an extremely detailed description of the project. It also gives a start date in February 1977, and it indicates that after a building period in 1977, construction will continue in the dry season of 1978. And I'll just read those parts now to give a flavor for the document. Quote, brothers began this work site on 16 February 1977. At the beginning, brothers start the construction of the dam from Trapyong Tama in the northwest direction, building it through the field of Trapyong Tama toward Punlay Mountain, which is 8,480 meters long. On the other side, brothers start from Trapyong Tama in the east direction, going by Poi Ta Ong village, turning northward behind Poi Pongro village, and then eastward to reach Suong Lake. And from the Suong Lake, it goes north through the plain of Suong Lake and Khan Kut Forest to reach Khaon Kleng Mountain. And this line is 14,800 meters long. In total, the dam of the Trapyong Tama Water Reservoir is 20 kilometers long, 5 meters high, 40 to 70 meters wide at the bottom, and 7 to 8 to 10 meters wide at the top. Down from the dam, brothers dig three big canals. Each is 12 meters wide on the top, 6 meters wide at the bottom, and 1 to 2 meters deep. The first canal, starting from the first water gate of the reservoir down to Rumdol River, is over 20 kilometers long. And then it continues with a description of the second and third canals, which I won't read. Then the portion about the continuing construction, it says, quote, in the dry season of next year, Brothers will strengthen and expand this reservoir, bigger and stronger, by increasing the height of the dam up to 8 meters, enlarging the bottom to 120 meters wide, and the top to 25 meters wide, so it will be able to hold hundreds of millions of cubic meters of water. Unquote. And before I continue with this document, I would just note that this description is consistent with the description in the site identification report, which is E3/8050. Now, this description is considerably more detailed than the description in the site ID report, but it is consistent. For example, the site ID report states that one arm of the dam is approximately 9 kilometers long, while the other is approximately 13 kilometers long. And that is at English ERN page 0042-8005, Khmer page 0046-4720, and French page 0045-0434. So this portion of this document we submit is relevant to the center's detailed knowledge of the project, the scale of the project, and the plans for future construction, future improvements. So I'd like to continue with this document. And the other things to note is that the document says that the dam was constructed in order to achieve the party's plan. And it also discusses the conditions that the workers worked under. And it discusses those conditions in the context of the conditions faced by the Khmer Rouge army during the war against the Lon Nol regime. So I'll just read that part now. It says, quote, "During the time of building this Trapeang Tmaw Reservoir, our cooperative male-female youths of the northern sector of Battambang used all of their physical and mental strength and sacrificed everything in order to serve the collective interest and to achieve the party's plan totally and successfully. Brothers worked and stayed at the work site for months, like what our male-female combatants of the Revolutionary Army had done when they were fighting to destroy the enemy during the war. Brothers fought to dig up and carry the earth all day and night under the burning sun for the entire dry season without any complaining. However, brothers were always happy at work. When the work became harder, brothers were more unified and closely and extraordinarily loved each other. Geographically, there were rarely any lakes or ponds on this plain field. And since there were tens of thousands of people working at the Trapeang Tmaw Water Reservoir worksite, our male-female youths had to face and fight to solve other problems besides their daily core task. Obviously, they had to face the problem of water shortage. That was because the carts and trucks were not able to deliver water to the work site on time and as needed. Even in this situation, brothers still had no doubt or did not complain about it. Instead, brothers agreed with a view and stance that our hardship here, whatever it was, still could not be compared to that of our elder cadres and male-female combatants of the Revolutionary Army when they were fighting to build the revolutionary forces and bases to destroy the enemy during the underground struggle in the internal war and during the past 5 years of the Revolutionary War. So this portion we submit is relevant to a number of things. First of all, the center's knowledge of the conditions that the workers were working under, that the workers were working there in order to achieve the party's plan totally and successfully, and also the scale of the workforce, saying that there were tens of thousands of people working at the reservoir worksite. The next document I want to move to is E3-300. And this document consists of excerpts from a Voice of Kampuchea news broadcast from Phnom Penh. So these excerpts specifically mention the Trapeang Tamaw Dam, and they put the project in the context of the CPK plan as a whole. So I'll read a few quotes in a moment, but first, the relevant ERNs are in Khmer S00704541, in English, S00702870, and in French, S00006803. So this broadcast was celebrating the 22nd anniversary of the founding of the Union of Kampuchean Workers, and that anniversary occurred on the 1st of November of 1977. So I'll just read a few excerpts. First, there's a section entitled, "The collectivist and private ownership systems are as different as day and night." And in that section, the broadcast said, "Under the just and far-sighted leadership of the Communist Party of Kampuchea, our people and our revolutionary army, adhering firmly to the position of independence, sovereignty, and self-reliance, established a new collective system, collectivist system, throughout Kampuchea in record time." Unquote. And it then goes on to explain some of what that collectivist system involved. And it says, quote, "As regards nation building, under this magnificent collectivist system, the rural areas in democratic Kampuchea have undergone profound transformations and are now entirely different from what they were during the war and before liberation. Water supply projects have been put in place in all the zones, regions, and districts," unquote. And then a bit further down, it gives examples of water supply projects undertaken, and it lists the Trapeang Tamaw Reservoir project as one of those. So again, the relevance is situating this project in the broader CPK program. The next document I would like to draw Your Honor's attention to is E3-18, which is Khieu Samphan's book entitled "Cambodia's Recent History and the Reasons Behind the Decisions I Made." And the relevant ERNs here are 0010-3780 in English, 0010-3878 in Khmer, and 0059-5487 in French. And I highlight this document only to draw your attention to the fact that Khieu Samphan discusses seeing the Trapeang Tamaw water reservoir at some point during the DK period between 75 and 79. And he also makes the same point in document in document E3-592, which is an open letter from Khieu Samphan. And in that document, he says the following, quote, "In addition, although I traveled very little in the years between 1975 and 79, I saw with my own eyes some achievements which I had long wanted to have, such as irrigating the countryside by channeling water from Trapeang Tamaw Water Reservoir, Phnom Srok District, Bantier Mienche Province, and Kampong Pui Water Reservoir, east of Battambang Province, and the endless rice paddies shaped in a checkerboard pattern. All of these made me believe in this regime and respect the souls of hundreds of thousands of those who had sacrificed their lives, as well as all of our people who were working hard in work sites." Unquote. And the relevance of this, we suggest, is Khieu Samphan's knowledge of the project and of its scale. And the ERN page for that document, English 0000-2803, French 0062-3766, and Khmer 0000-2799. The next document I'd like to turn to is E3/178, which is a weekly report of the Sector 5 Committee from May 1977, and specifically it's dated 21 May 1977. It's addressed to the Zone Secretary and to M560, and it contains, it contains a number of pieces of information relevant to the Trappes-Entremont Dam work site. The first portion that I'd like to read is entitled About the Reservoir. And it says, the strategic water reservoir in Trappes-Entremont, the construction of the water gates for the three major directions are being continued. That is, the construction of the lower part will be finished in this May. The construction of the upper part will be finished later on. The water dam and water gates at Chung Cross were completed. The 23-kilometer canal that connects from the first water gate of Trappes-Entremont to Anlong Sar River, whose upper mouth is 12 meters, the low bottom is 6 meters, the depth is 1 meter, has been completed. So this portion is relevant to two things. First, reporting from the sector level upward, and also the future construction plans, where it says the construction of the upper part will be finished later on. And that passage is at English page 0034-2719. Khmer page 0027-5596 and French page 0062-3317. So the second thing I want to mention in this document is that it describes what it characterizes as attempts to sabotage the project, which it attributes to 17 April people. And I'll read that portion now. Quote, by searching and finding the traitors, the 17 April elements from Phnom Penh, who have prepared a plan to destroy our water reservoir. By searching and realizing the enemy's trick, in which they have hidden the tools, such as hoes, knives, saws, axes, etc. They have waged this trick in order to prevent us from using the tools. And if we mobilize or appoint them to work, they would allege that there were no tools to work with. We have successively searched for and found those who wore insignias and the traitors who were the 17 April elements from Phnom Penh. The examination of their activities are based on their confessions of their networks and based on the photographs for which the Ankar has asked to search, unquote. And that's English page 0034-2709, Khmer 0027-5587, and French 0062-3305. And the last thing I would draw the Chamber's attention to in this document is a statement that the Sector Committee is trying to promote, quote, trust in the party's plan by trying to sincerely implement all parts of the 77 plan of the party, unquote. And that's at page 0034-2711 in English, 0027-5589 in Khmer, and 0062-3307 in French. So again, the relevance here is both illustrating the search for enemies related to the reservoir project and situating situating the project in the CPK program as a whole. The next document is E3/179, and this is a report from Office 560 dated 29 May 1977. So this document is 8 days after the previous document. And it comes from an entity that was an addressee of the previous document. It contains information about a number of the sectors in the Northwest Zone. For Sector 5, it includes the following information. Quote, the building of 3 sluice gates of Utasas Strategic Water Basin at Trapeng Tamaw is underway and is expected to finish in May. We have completed a canal of 23 kilometers long, 1 meter deep, with an upper base of 12 meters and a lower base of 6 meters wide, unquote. And those ERNs are English 0018-3016-17, Khmer 0000-8501, and French 0023-6772. And the interesting aspect of this document is that it's 6 days after the previous document, and it appears to contain a summary of the information in the previous document. The next two documents I want to deal with are from a year later, so May of 1978, rather than May of 1977. These are telegrams sent by NIM to Ankar 870. And the first one is E3/950. And it is dated 11 May 1978. And NIM starts by writing the following to Ankar 870. Quote, I would like to report on general situation and work and zone in the zone in the following. Number one, following my meeting with Ankar, I returned and went to work in regions 5, 3, 1, and 4. On May 10, I met and worked with comrades of the Permanent Organizational Assignment Committee. During my meeting with them, I reported about the recommendations of 870, and then we reviewed situations in the zone as follows, unquote. And then further down in the document, there is a section entitled Planting and Building in All Areas. And within that section, there is a portion that says, quote, water reservoirs in Region 5. Trapeng Tamaw water reservoir has been promoted, unquote. And so the word promoted here in May of 1978, I would just recall that this is from near the end of the dry season in 1978, and therefore it appears to be consistent with the Revolutionary Youth magazine that we looked at initially. So in this telegram, Nim also discusses his cooperation with a cadre from the Southwest Zone, Tarin, and discussing the food situation, it says, quote, it was said that the entire 4 districts of Region 5 faced shortage, but I have met with Comrade Rin and proposed to him to review all the harvested rice to see what it lacked, how many months the paddy rice would ripe, and what the rations were, unquote. And finally, at the end of the document, Nim writes, quote, please, Ankar, give ideas and advice, unquote. And the pages that I've quoted from in this document are English 0018-5215 through 18, Khmer 00021043-45, and French 0029-6221-23. So the relevance of this document in our submission is, first it discusses the Trappes-Montmartre Dam, and it also illustrates the functioning of the hierarchy in the Northwest Zone in May of 78. The second telegram from Nîmes to Ankar 870 is from 6 days later. That document is E3/863. And it's dated 17 May 1978. And like the previous one, it's also from Nîmes to Ankar 870. And in this telegram, Nîmes again mentions his cooperation with Tahrir on food matters. Specifically, he says, quote, "But Sector 5 still has a problem with seed shortage for early season rice. I worked with Comrade Rin on this problem, asking him to send me 14,000 sacks of rice and seed, of rice seed, so that we can plant them on the whole land areas as planned by him." And that is English page 0032-1961, French 0062-3408, and Khmer 0007-6286. And again, the significance of this document is to show the functioning of the hierarchy around the Northwest Zone leader in May of 1978. The next two documents I want to look at both deal with something that has been mentioned quite a few times, and that's the visit of Chen Yung-kwe to Cambodia in December of 1977. And the first document is E3/1783. This document is a Xinhua news agency report, so the Chinese press agency. It establishes that the visit occurred in early December 1977, and it also establishes that Chen Yung-kwe was accompanied on his visit by Pol Pot. It also indicates that Ross Nim met with Pol Pot and Chen Yung-kwe and gave them a sort of presentation about the construction of the reservoir, including the fact that the construction was done in response to the call of the party's central committee. And this is what it says specifically. Quote, excuse me. Quote, "Comrade Nimros, second vice president of the Presidium of the State of Democratic Cambodia, secretary of the Northwest Zone Committee of the KCP, and chairman of the Northwest Zone Serve the People Committee, said that the reservoir was built in less than 2 months this year by the people of the 5th region of the Northwest Zone in response to the call of the party's central committee to build water conservancy projects in a big way. This year, it holds 150 million cubic meters of water. Then, three canals were dug in a week's time, linking the reservoir, which irrigates over 7,000 hectares of paddy fields. The reservoir is now being expanded. After 4 years, it will hold 300 million cubic meters of water." And he also talked about the conditions. Ross Nim said, quote, "Drought set in when we started to build the reservoir, and the 20,000 people engaged in construction even had not enough drinking water," unquote. And there the relevant ERNs are English 0049-8180-81, Khmer 0065-9259-60 and French 0060-6766. So this, again, is relevant to the ongoing construction point, discussing the plans to expand the reservoir in December of 1977. It's also relevant to the knowledge of the conditions of high-level party leaders. And finally, the scale of the workforce, 20,000 people. The second document on this topic is E3/1339, and this is the last one was a Chinese press service report. This is the Phnom Penh domestic press service report from a FIBIS document. The English ERN is 0016-8341, and at the moment there are no French or Khmer translations for this portion. So this deals with the same event. It describes how Chen Yongkui traveled from Siem Reap to the Northwest Zone in the company of Pol Pot and Vuon Vet. And it also describes Ross Nim's involvement in the event as follows. Quote, at the boundary between the northern and northwestern regions, comrade Chen Yongkui and other Chinese comrades were warmly greeted by comrade Ross Nin, secretary of the KCP Northwestern Region Committee and chairman of the Northwestern Region Serve the People Committee, unquote. And it then goes on to mention the visit to the reservoir at Trapang Tma that afternoon. The next document I'd like to look at also deals with a visit of foreigners. This deals with the visit of Yugoslav journalists. And this document is E3/4604, which is the issue of Revolutionary Flag magazine from April 1978. And it contains something called the presentation of the Comrade Secretary of the Communist Party of Kampuchea on the occasion of the third anniversary of the great victory of 17 April. So that's basically the contents of this edition of the magazine, is this presentation. And the particular section that mentions the Trapang Tma water reservoir, the section is called, quote, next, I want to inform you about item two, to speak about building the country, unquote. And that section says the following, quote, the movement to resolve water was vast, mighty, and huge. I wish to report in the name of the party, in the name of the government, to this meeting, that we have built many water reservoirs of 100 million cubic meters and above, like seas. Yugoslav journalists came to look at our reservoir in Battambang, called Trapang Tma at Phnom Srok. Looking at it, they could not see the banks, and they said they had just come from Kampong Saum and seen the sea at Kampong Saum before coming to look at the reservoir at Phnom Srok and Battambang. They said there was another sea there. They were impressed with this sea, meaning that the reservoir was big, vast, water as far as the eye can see, nearly 200 million cubic meters. We built it in just 1 year. So again, relevance is to the duration of construction. Here it's given as 1 year. And also to the scale of the project and the party center's knowledge of the scale of the project. And the relevant ERNs are English 0051-9843, Khmer 0006-4727, and French 0051-9843. That must be a mistake. That's the same as the English ERN. I'll get the correct French ERN. So I want to turn now to a few written records of interview. And these are relevant specifically to the later conditions and the later period of construction after the Southwest Zone cadres had arrived. And the first one I want to look at in that regard is E319/19.3.33. So in this question, in this WRI at question 9, the witness was asked, what were your responsibilities at Trappeng Tamal? And his answer was, quote, I carried dirt and helped build the dam. Ms. Ngan was the chief of the Tmapok District Mobile Unit, and San was the deputy chief. Both were from the Southwest Zone. Wong, deceased, was another deputy chief. He was from the Northwest Zone. Then skipping down a bit in the same answer, quote, Taiyun, from the Southwest Zone, was in charge of all of the mobile units and Trappeng Tamal, unquote. The next question the witness was asked, question and answer 10, he was asked the standard question, would you like to add anything else, unquote. And what he said was, quote, I would like to add that life under the Southwest Zone People's Authority was extremely hard because we received an insufficient food supply despite hard work and because they killed a lot of people. Sometimes we had to work day and night, unquote. So the relevance of this is, of course, to conditions under the Southwest Zone, but also Taiyun as one of the successors of Taval. The next document in this regard is E319/21.3.5. And the portion I'll be quoting here is answer 27 and 28. Question.
Je suis intéressé par les questions 27
You said that you work in a mobile unit.
Dites que vous avez travaillé dans une unité mobile à Trappeng Tamal.
And at the Spienstreng
worksite.
Tell us what the living conditions and working situation were. What were they like after the Southwest cadres arrived?
Answer 27.
Before the Southwest cadres arrived, they had us dig 2 to 3 cubic meters of soil per day. When the Southwest cadres arrived, they had us carry 3 cubic meters of soil. As for the food rations, it was the same for those who worked in mobile units. There was not enough food to eat. They had us carry soil both day and night before and after the Southwest cadres arrived. Question. Were the situation and the arrests and killings the same as before the Southwest people arrived?
Answer 28.
Actually, before the Southwest cadres arrived, arrests and killings were not frequent, but after the Southwest cadres arrived, the arrests and killings of people became more frequent.
La fréquence a augmenté.
Unquote. The next document in this regard is E319/19.3.47. And this is question and answer 18. The witness was asked who controlled Sector 5 mobile unit during the time he worked at the Trappeng Tamal Dam. And he answered, quote, Taval controlled the Sector 5 mobile units that worked at Trappeng Tamal Dam, unquote. He was then asked about his roles at Trappeng Tamal Dam, and he said the following, quote, I controlled a 30-member unit. I worked at Trappeng Tamal for 3 months, during which Trappeng Tamal Dam was completed before Khmer New Year in 1977. Perhaps in May 1977, the Southwest Group arrived, disbanded the mobile units, and began to arrest the Northwest leadership cadres, such as the chiefs of mobile units and the chiefs of battalions and regiments. I was transferred to work at Corps by Down. Actually, trapping Tamar Dam was successfully completed,
on avait terminé les travaux
except
du barrage
a number of bridges
sauf quelques
that were still incomplete.
Qui n'avaient pas encore été achevés.
Now, earlier in the interview at question 13,
plus tôt, dans cet entretien,
he had been asked,
13, on avait demandé au témoin,
could you please describe the living and working conditions,
de vie, les conditions de travail,
under the control of the Southwest group and the Northwest group?
Et du groupe du Nord-Ouest.
And he answered, quote,
le témoin a répondu,
the living and working conditions,
les conditions
under
de travail
the control of the Northwest
sous le contrôle du groupe du Nord-Ouest
were better than those
étaient meilleures
under the control
lorsque sous le
of the Southwest
du groupe du Sud-Ouest.
Because we had sufficient food.
Nous avions assez à manger.
By contrast, under the control of the Southwest group,
sous le contrôle
things were extremely difficult
c'était très difficile car
because we did not have sufficient
nous n'avions
food.
Pas assez à manger.
The next WRI on this point is
E319/19.3.24.
And this is another witness who worked at the Trapping Tamar construction site at the time that he says that Imchaim arrived in the area in July or August of 1977. And again, the question he was asked was, do you have anything to add? And he said the following, quote, I want to add that under the Khmer Rouge era, under the control of both the Northwest and Southwest people,
sous le contrôle
the living was extremely difficult,
et du
and we did not receive enough food
très
difficile,
et nous ne recevions pas assez à manger.
And the last document I want to deal with
le
on this particular point
portant sur ce sujet
is E319/21.3.3. Here, in question 103, the witness was asked, you previously said that Taval was the highest ranking leader at Trapping Tamar Dam. After he was arrested, who came to replace him? And his answer was, quote, Tapol came from the southwest zone to replace him, unquote. And then at question 105, the witness was asked of Tapol, was he from the southwest zone? And his answer was, quote, yes, he was. He was vicious. He had crossed eyes, unquote. Later in the interview, he was asked about rapes that he had mentioned in his civil party application.
À cette personne à propos de viol dont il avait fait état dans sa constitution,
women,
demande de constituer le parti civil et il répond. Deux femmes
from Prianet Pria district
de
Prianet Pria
étaient des soignantes dans mon unité.
They were taken to be killed
elles ont
by
été emmenées
Tapol,
pour être exécutées par Tapol,
who was from the southwest,
qui venait du sud-ouest,
and one of his associates.
Et un de ses associés.
I did not see this killing firsthand.
Je n'ai pas vu l'exécution.
But the workers in my unit told me that the corpses
unité m'ont dit
of the two women were left completely naked.
De ces deux femmes était complètement
and he then goes on to say that because the corpses had been left naked, he assumed
si
the women had been raped.
Nus, il tenait pour acquis qu'elles avaient été violées.
So the same witness at answers 92 through 94
même témoin, aux réponses 92
was asked
à 94,
what life was like after the Southwest group arrived.
La vie après l'arrivée
and
des
he
gens
said
du
that
Sud-Ouest.
Living conditions became more difficult.
Plus
when asked about food,
quand
he said, quote,
pour sujet de
they provided
il a
only
ceci.
A single can of rice
ils ne nous ont donné qu'une
to
seule
be shared
de riz.
Between
nous
30
partager
people,
entre 30 personnes.
And they had us work
et
both day and night,
nuit et jour.
Unquote. And at answer 94, he was asked,
94, on lui a demandé,
after the Southwest group took charge, what was the situation
quelle
with
était la
disappearances
situation
and arrests? And,
des arrestations après l'arrivée du groupe
and
du
he said, quote, yes, more and more people
oui,
disappeared
de plus en plus
or were arrested.
Ou ont été arrêtés.
Mr. President, I'm turning to a new topic now,
Monsieur
and I know the time. I don't know if it's a convenient
sujet,
time for a break.
Peut-être que le moment est opportun pour une pause.
President, thank you.
Merci.
It is now convenient to have a short break.
Effectivement,
we take a break now and resume at 3 p.m.
À 15 heures.
Sumptuary culture.